resemble something like this, where you've got icebergs and matrix material pushed up, but the entire thing frozen out. And so in the next slide, we have an image of what that process might look like. It's just a cartoon image. On the left, we're showing a collapsing lake with icebergs popped up above the surface and the matrix material starting to fill up with salt-rich water from the lake below. This is the process that breaks up the surface and causes it to look the way we think it does. On the right-hand side, we see a snapshot of this process much later, once the water in the lake has actually frozen out. One of the interesting observations of Europa has been that there are chaos features that are dropped down below the surface and chaos features that are perched up above the surface with these dome-like textures. They always have in common some icebergs or some broken up material, but one's down and one's high. And what this does is to put those in perspective as kind of like a time scale. Drop down means active today with a liquid water lens, and frozen out is popped up above the surface with domes and solid icebergs. And so if you go to the next slide, this is that first image that I showed you of the two chaos terrains. But in fact, in this case, we're showing you the topography overlaid on top of the image. In this image, blue means low and red means high. If you look at the image on the left, which is theramacular, you'll notice that the center of the feature is depressed down below the surface. In fact, as much as 400 to 800 meters, which means that a giant pocket of liquid water still exists below this body today. What's also interesting is just like in this glass of water, the icebergs are popped up above the surface. If we look on the right image of Connemara chaos, you'll notice that instead the terrain is much lumpier and it's characterized by this reddish color, which means that the surface is popped up and it's filled with water and then frozen. And so on the left we have an active feature, on the right we have an older feature that had a lake at one time but might have already frozen out today. We've also prepared a video for you of how the process might look on Europa, so we're going to show you that. As we come into the video, you're going to see we're flying by Jupiter, zooming into Europa, that second moon of Jupiter, covered with ice, and we're snapping into a thin section so you can see, in fact, the process start to happen. If you notice, there's warm ice down from the bottom right near the ocean interface, moving its way up, causing warming and causing melting kind of right in the middle of the ice shell. As that lake starts to form, it brings the surface down because water takes up less volume than the ice it replaces. So the surface collapses down, the icebergs start to float around, break up the ice around it, and then as it refreezes, it's free to dome back up and create the features that we see today that look like Connemara chaos. So this is, in fact, what we think it might be like on Europa as these features are forming. And to turn back to the Earth example, here is a video of this process happening in Greenland, a very similar process. What you're looking at is Jakobshavn Glacier as icebergs calve from the front of the glacier, turn over, and exist. There you go, big iceberg flipping over and floating around in a matrix of broken up brash ice, which is rich in water, but still really a solid. So this is what it might look like on Europa if we were witnessing it relatively live. So Tom Wagner is going to tell you a little bit more about the Earth's frozen environments.
Yeah, and if we could have the first slide. I thought we'd start with just a really brief description of ice shelves, which, as Brittany pointed out, is probably our best analog for what's happened with the ice on Europa. And what happens is this. You take a place like Greenland or Antarctica, you build up a lot of ice and snow in the middle until it literally gets miles thick. And then it begins to flow out to the sides, just like if I poured honey on the table right here, how it would flow out. Well, what happens when that ice hits the ocean is it begins to float. And that floating glacier is what an ice shelf is. They can be many hundreds of feet thick. They can extend out many, many, many miles, hundreds of miles in some cases. In fact, the Ross Ice Shelf is the size of France in Antarctica. Next slide. But ice shelves are also remarkably dynamic features. Most people had thought they were kind of stable, but here we saw in 2008, the Wilkins Ice Shelf in Antarctica, literally over the course of a couple of weeks, it blew apart in one of what my colleagues describes as the mosh pit. And what happened was this ice, as it flowed out, it got a little thinner. Eventually, it triggered a collapse, which then triggered a further collapse, and it tumbled away like giant dominoes. Next slide. Some of these dominoes, though, are miles long and hundreds of feet thick, and they turn over and rotate. And also, as Brittany pointed out, that matrix material that we see on Europa probably would look something like this, which is brash ice, which is the broken up bits that fill in beneath these, between these bergs as they bump into each other. Next slide. This process is profoundly important for us on Earth also. And this example is the Larsen Ice Shelf, which is on the Antarctic Peninsula that extends up towards South America. In 2002, an area the size of Rhode Island again collapsed just over the course of a couple of weeks. Picture giant tablets just tumbling away, things hundreds of feet thick, right, over a giant, like as big as a U.S. state. What happened, though, that was so remarkable was that the glaciers on the land behind it, off to the left side of the screen that you're looking at, they sped up dramatically as you kind of popped the cork or pulled away this ice shelf. Some of them increased their speed eightfold. They went so fast that they drained all the ice that was behind them, and the surface deflated by over 150 feet in some cases, over 600 feet in other cases, just over the course of 5 or 6 years. So this is really important because when we try to project future sea level rise on the planet, we think that this is probably the most dynamic element that we have to take into account because there's ice shelves all around Antarctica. Next slide. And this is one of the most important ice shelves for that sea level rise work that I spoke about. This is the Pine Island Glacier Ice Shelf. And this is, we have studied these processes in great detail. And one thing you should realize is that it's not a huge extrapolation to go from what we're doing on Earth to Europa, because we have satellites and aircraft where we can study these things all the way down to the base levels. In this case, what you're looking at, the gray is the surface of the ice shelf, which was shot by LIDAR from an aircraft, literally a little laser rastering over the surface. Underneath that, the next layer, that kind of mountainous colored stuff, is the base of the ice shelf, which was with radar. As amazing as it sounds, we can put a radar under an airplane and map the structure of the ice and the bottom of the ice. Under there would be the ocean. And then the bottom is actually the sea floor, which we map by a gravimeter. It's really important to us because, again, like the Europa case where you have warm water that's causing melting and fracturing in things, what our big fear on Earth is that warm water in the ocean is getting underneath these ice shelves and destabilizing them. And what we have to do is we have to get the topography of the under ice shelf, we have to get the topography of the seafloor to understand how coastal waters mix in. Next slide. But the last slide that I want to show you is actually a radar image over a subglacial lake, literally like one of these perched lakes we're talking about on Europa. In Antarctica, there are over 140 of these lakes. It was shocking to me. I started working in the Antarctic world probably about 7 or 8 years ago, and we didn't really know there was that much water around. And now through radar studies like this, that vertical scale is about 4 kilometers. And you see the flat line in the bottom? That's where the radar waves have bounced off the surface of the lake. That lake is the size of Lake Ontario. And with that, I'll pass off to Tori, who's going to tell us about habitability on Europa.
Thanks, Tom. So one of the things that makes Europa so exciting, that has made it such a compelling object of study for decades, is the presence of this liquid water ocean that meets one of the critical requirements for life. And what you're hearing about today from Brittany bears on a second of life's crucial requirements, and that is the requirement for energy. So habitability is a concept that we all can relate to personal experience as living organisms. Anybody on the street could give you a pretty good accounting of what it takes to stay alive: water, food, shelter, air to breathe. So if we think about these things in the context of Europa, there is absolutely no shortage of water there. That we know and have known for more than a decade. As far as we know, the environment is relatively sheltering if we think about shelter as the set of conditions that allow life to persist in an environmental context. Most of what we can conceive as a potential Europan ocean chemistry would be reasonably suitable for life. But the big and open question has been one of energy. And when we talk about food to eat and air to breathe, what we're really talking about is our requirement for energy. And I've tried to conceptualize how to think of this in terms of a figure. So you could view Europa as something like a great big battery. It's stored energy. And the question has been whether or not that stored energy is actually available for life on Europa. So if you took a normal D-cell battery and cut it away, what you would see is chemically different layers that are isolated from one another. It's energy that's stored. And the way to tap that energy, as you can see in the second slide, is to connect the terminals. When you connect the terminals with a wire, electrons flow from place to place. That flow of electrons is what we call electricity. But in essence, what's happening is a movement of material from the outer layer to the inner layer that serves to release energy. So in the next slide, you can see that we can view Europa in much the same way. We know from spacecraft observations of surface chemistry, from inference of the chemistry of Europa's crust, that it represents, in essence, stored energy. But with this big, thick, 10-kilometer or more ice shell, The big open question has been, does that energy ever get released? Is it ever available in the ocean? What you're hearing about here today, if we can have the last slide, would be a way to take this surface material, transport it potentially down into the ocean, and in essence tap Europa's battery. And when you tap that battery, you've moved from a system that checks one of the requirements for a life to a system that checks a second critical requirement for life. And I think this really impacts the way that we consider habitability on Europa. So how should we view this in the big context of Europan ocean exploration? I think Louise is the person to address this.
Thank you, Tori. Well, this new model is very exciting in many respects because it ties together a lot of loose ends from Europa studies that have spanned most of the last decade. Here in the first slide, I'm showing a figure that represents two previous models for Europa's shell. The one on the left shows the ocean and the ice shell. The total thickness of this is about 150 kilometers. But here the shell is depicted as being very thin, maybe only 5 kilometers or less. And the plumes that you're seeing here would be in the ocean. They're hydrothermal plumes from the floor, from where the ocean floor meets the mantle of Europa. On the right-hand side is a depiction of a thicker shell model, where the shell here would be about 15 to 30 kilometers. It's not quite to scale. But the underlying plumes from the ocean floor would impinge on the bottom of the ice shell and would warm it, and as such would create plumes within the shell. These are convective plumes, so it's actually solid material that is mobilized because it's slightly warmer than the surrounding, so similar to what you would see in a saucepan of bubbling soup. I'm told miso soup does this very well. But you can see different convection cells, and material moves upwards in the center and down at the margins. And these two models have been used to explain some of the observations we've seen on the surface of Europa, but neither of them have been able to explain everything we see, and that's been a big problem for us. But with the new model that Brittany and her colleagues have put together, we can now explain pretty much every geological observation that we see surrounding chaos on Europa. So it's really sort of come along and joined together a lot of dots. So we're very happy to see that. Next, I want to talk about the distribution of chaos and its age. If you look at this image of Europa, you can see that the surface looks very different from, say, the surface of the Moon or Mercury. Those bodies are very heavily impact cratered. They've got a lot of cratering scars on them, whereas Europa, you can see, has hardly any. In fact, I'm not sure you can even make any out at this scale. Now, we use the number of impact craters on the surface of a body as a proxy for age. We assume that things like comets and meteorites that are coming into a system impact the surface on a fairly constant basis. And so if something has a lot of them, that means that it's been sitting there getting this weathering process for a very long time. Whereas if something doesn't have many craters, it's probably very young. And in the case of Europa, something has happened to erase the impact scars from the surface. And in this case, it could be tectonic features, so faults and fractures on the surface that could erase whatever's come before. It could be some kind of cryovolcanism, and it certainly could be chaos. So if we can start the movie, please. And in fact, the average age of Europa is thought to only be about 60 million years. Now, on human timescales, that's a very long time, but in geological timescales, that's a blink of an eye. It was almost born yesterday on the surface. So Europa already has a very young surface age. And here we're zooming into Thera Macula on the left, which Brittany talked about earlier, and a chaos very close to it, Thrace Macula on the right. As you can see, they're both quite large. Thera is about 80 kilometers, maybe a little over 50 miles across. And notice that these are very different from their surroundings. They're both very dark. They have unusual scalloped margins. They don't look like a lot of the long linear features that we see that appear to be faults and fractures. And these two arrows are pointing towards a semicircular fracture system that was once intact. We're looking at the two sides of it. And you can see that Thrace Macula on the right has actually disrupted the middle of that. It's completely destroyed it, in fact. And so this shows that this chaos region overlies those tectonic features, and so it's much younger. So what we're showing here is not only is Europa's surface young, but chaos is very young still. And in fact, it's one of the youngest feature types, if not the major young landform on the surface. So it's very, very young. Here I'm just zooming out, showing you the equator. There's a big X just off the center to the left, just to the south of that, is Connemara Chaos, which Brittany also mentioned earlier. But you can see all this brown, mottled material over the surface. All of that is chaos terrain. It's very widespread. In fact, we think, estimates vary